Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar series, where great professors teach you. My name is Richard Poe, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled From Here to Infinity, an exploration of science fiction literature. Your professor is Michael D.C. Drout, the William and Elsie Prentice Professor of English at Wheaton College, where he teaches courses in Old and Middle English, medieval literature, Chaucer, fantasy, and science fiction. Professor Drought received his Ph.D. in medieval literature from Loyola University in 1997. He also holds M.A. degrees from Stanford and the University of Missouri, Columbia, and a B.A. from Carnegie Mellon. In 2005, Professor Drought was awarded the Prentice Professorship for Outstanding and Innovative Teaching. The Wheaton College Class of 2002 awarded him their Faculty Appreciation Award. He is editor of J.R.R. Tolkien's Beowulf and the Critics, which won the Mythopoetic Scholarship Award for Inklings Studies for 2003. Drought is one of the founding editors of the journal Tolkien Studies and is editor of the J.R.R. Tolkien Encyclopedia. He has also published articles on Ursula Le Guin's Earthsea books and Susan Cooper's Dark is Rising series of children's fantasy novels. Drought has written an Old English grammar book, King Alfred's Grammar, which is available for free at his website, www.michaeldrout.com. The release of the movie Star Wars changed the way many people looked at science fiction. Long the domain of paperback novels and comic books, the splashy special effects of fighting starships and lightsabers won the genre a whole new audience, as well as the devotion of a generation of children who would grow up on the images of spaceships and strange planets. But this brave new world did not spring fully formed from the movie screen. For decades, dedicated writers had been building up an intricate and wildly diverse body of literature. From the golden age of rocket ships and ray guns to the cool gaze of the surrealists, science fiction had been a hotbed of some of the most remarkable creativity of the century. In the pages of dime store novels and obscure journals, in the occasional bestseller and epic series, science fiction had been changing and growing, developments that its sudden popularity threatened to overwhelm. But the seed work done by the great authors of its early and middle period would continue to inspire writers, even under the shadow of massive public success, as they turned to the heritage of their field and discovered new ways of looking at the world and at themselves. By studying the history of science fiction, we can join with these new voices and find inspiration in their great masterworks for our own dreams and visions of the future. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin From Here to Infinity, an exploration of science fiction literature, Lecture 1. What is science fiction? And now, Professor Drought.
Science fiction, along with fantasy literature, is by far the most popular selling genre of literature of the 20th century. A lot of people would say that it's diagnostic or characteristic of the 20th century, even though, as we'll see, there was science fiction as long ago as the early 1800s. But it is a 20th century, maybe even a 21st century now phenomenon, and it's enormously influential. It spreads throughout popular culture, political culture. We have Star Wars, missile defense. We worry about Andromeda strain viruses. And people just know what those are because of how influential science fiction has been. Film is dominated by science fiction and fantasy, with of the top 10 grossing films of all time, about five of them, depending on how you count and how you figure these things out and whether you count sequels, but more than half of them are science fiction and another three are fantasy. Science fiction even has driven discovery itself. Arthur C. Clarke proposed a telecommunications satellite, and then people went out and built one. William Gibson wrote a cautionary tale about the internet. People misinterpreted what he said and went out and tried to make it. Robert Heinlein came up with a idea called Waldos, these remote manipulators, based on a story of his, and scientists and engineers went out and built them. So science fiction has driven discovery, it's influenced culture, and it's given people a new way of thinking and talking about the world. In this course, we're going to look at science fiction from its earliest roots back in the early 1800s and continue right up to the present day. But we're not just going to move forward in strict chronological order. We're going to take some side detours. We're going to look at some of the big questions that science fiction raises. And our overall theme in the course is to see what science fiction can tell us about human beings and the human condition. Science fiction asks some really big questions about what it means to be human, about what our societies can be, about what our capabilities will be in the future. And it doesn't necessarily provide answers, but it opens up a realm of speculation and discussion that other literature has a lot of trouble dealing with. Now, in this course, I'm going to refer to science fiction as SF a lot of the time, and this is actually a very political decision, because if you call it sci-fi, that usually means that you're either not in the know or that you're a critic in a negative sense of it. In other words, calling something sci-fi and making fun of it or putting it down. That's, in fact, another use of the word genre. We talk about genres, and those are categories. You can fantasy, science fiction, historical fiction, romance are all genres. But that's also a kind of pejorative term. You can say something is just genre, and then you can dismiss it and not pay attention to it. Now, sometimes there are science fiction writers who sneak out of the genre ghetto, or people even argue that they're not really science fiction because they're so good. That's my favorite description of Thomas Pynchon, who I'm not sure actually if he is science fiction or not, but certainly the argument that he's such a great writer that he can't be a science fiction writer reveals more about the critic than it does about Thomas Pynchon. Science fiction has been rather immune to the slings and arrows of the critics also. It continues to be popular, and more mainstream critics, scholars, college courses tend to be devoted to science fiction. There are certainly figures in science fiction, titans like Kurt Vonnegut or Ray Bradbury, who have been recognized as a long time as saying something important about American culture in their time period. But it's becoming more and more the case that writers who were really considered just genre or popular, like Robert Heinlein or Ursula Le Guin, or more recently Neal Stephenson, William Gibson, are being seen as important cultural representatives. In fact, science fiction has its own kind of school of literary criticism. It's got its own journals. It's got its own aesthetics. If you look at something like Locus Reviews, for example, the people who are writing for that are incredibly knowledgeable about science fiction, and they're also incredibly knowledgeable about mainstream literature as well, being able to connect and compare science fiction to mainstream literature. This is sadly not necessarily the case for kind of mainstream literary criticism, the kind of New York Times Review of Books criticism, that doesn't seem to understand science fiction entirely from the inside, and so gets things kind of sadly wrong when they deign to look at science fiction. On the other hand, that is slowly changing as there's more and more knowledgeable critics about both the genre and its place in the wider world. It's also the case that some major writers of science fiction are also major critics, and that's shaped the field in a way that's somewhat similar to what happens in mainstream literature. So Brian Aldiss, Thomas Dish, and Ursula Le Guin are all really important critics of science fiction, and they're also major important authors who we'll be discussing. Even when these critics are at their best, they tend to set up aesthetic tests and criticism that makes their own work seem to be the best kind of science fiction. So we have to be a little bit aware of that. But that's the same thing in mainstream criticism as well. We're still laboring under the shadow of Henry James, and Henry James really came up with most of his aesthetic theories to justify the fact that he thought his novels were the best ones. So it's not unusual for someone to do that. The other interesting thing about science fiction and its criticism and its place in the culture is that science fiction doesn't have one titan in the field that dominates everyone else. Fantasy labors under the shadow of J.R.R. Tolkien. Everybody who writes fantasy has to deal with Tolkien somehow. It's like Shakespeare in mainstream literature. I hope that comparison doesn't seem too far-fetched. But the point is, one writer who is so powerful, who is so important, who shaped the genre, that everyone else has to somehow relate to that. There isn't someone like that in science fiction. In the 1940s and 50s, there were their so-called Big Three, Arthur C. Clarke, Isaac Asimov, and Robert Heinlein. But even looking back now, 40 to 50 years, it turns out that some of their works are not really as important as they once were. They haven't weathered as well as others. And nobody really feels the need to write in Heinlein's shadow or to kill off Isaac Asimov's influence. You can just take things in your own direction, and that's what a lot of writers have done. So science fiction is fragmented and it's diverse in a way that fantasy literature really isn't. You can see whole kind of subgenres in science fiction of time travel stories, space travel stories, aliens, weird monsters on Earth, science experiments gone wrong, artificial consciousness. I could keep going and come up with all these subgenres. And writers in those subgenres tend to write off of what previous writers have done. Writers who are writing about artificial consciousness often take a chance to either slam or agree with Isaac Asimov's laws of robotics, which we'll talk about in one of the future lectures. On the other hand, it's a little bit easier to map out the boundaries of science fiction than it is with fantasy. There are certainly overlaps. There's science fiction and historical fiction, horror fiction, fantasy and romance, and all those things kind of cross-cut across science fiction. Yes, even romance. Anne McCaffrey, for example, very, very popular science fiction writer. But her books follow the romance blueprint. Boy meets girl, boy loses girl, boy gets girl again, boy and girl ride some dragons and attack monsters from outer space. You know, it follows the romance blueprint with a science fiction twist. The best way I found to separate science fiction from fantasy is to point out that fantasy is usually set in an imaginary past, and science fiction is set in an imaginary future. This is not 100%, but it's a good rule of thumb that you can use to separate the two things out. Also, fantasy uses magic. Science fiction uses technology. It's true that magic and technology blend into each other. Arthur C. Clarke's third law says, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. And there's some corollaries to that third law, one of them being Harry Potter's law, that's any sufficiently debased magic is indistinguishable from technology. And those two things together make a clear point that if you don't know how something works, it might as well be magic. And on the other hand, if something is magic but you know how well it works so much that you can follow a blueprint or go to the store and buy some, then it works very much like technology. So that lets us separate out fantasy and technology a little bit there. Another big difference between science fiction and fantasy is that there's at least an attempt, usually, in science fiction to explain the technology in terms of the already known laws of physics and chemistry. And if the technology breaks those laws of physics and chemistry, science fiction writers usually come up with a reason why it's okay to break those laws. Why, for example, you can have faster-than-light travel, which, according to the all-known laws of physics, you can't have faster-than-light travel. However, if you want to have people going to other star systems, you have to have faster-than-light travel for the logic of the story. And so you get a lot of hand-waving about the Horst Conrad impellers that grasp at the very fabric of space-time. And no one explains what those things are or how they do that grasping. But that's what science fiction would do, whereas fantasy would probably say something like, he stepped through the portal and was in the next star system or next to the dragon or something like that. In general, then, we have a future setting, an attempt to link up with known physical laws. Now, the other place that science fiction and other genres really closely overlap, especially in contemporary science fiction, is with historical fiction. Historical fiction is usually things either that did happen, but are told from the point of view of characters who don't get mentioned in the histories, or a new kind of historical fiction, which is often called alternative history or contrafactual. Harry Turtledove is the great writer in this genre. Attempts to figure out what history would be like if something different had happened. So what if the South had won the Civil War? What would be the ramifications later on? And Harry Turtledove has a great story where the South has won the Civil War, and so the North ends up aligned with Germany for World War II. And it's a very bizarre, really interesting story. Same with some he does where a Roman legion gets transported in time to alternative futures. So there is science fiction historical fiction, the most famous example being Neal Stephenson's Cryptonomicon, which is also called Slipstream, though I don't find that a very helpful term, but which is set in a historical past but changes some things to make them that didn't happen and also kinds of fit in the interstices between real events and fake events, mixes in real characters, historical characters like Douglas MacArthur or Alan Turing with made-up characters. And science fiction plays a role there because there's a lot of science fiction that has been kind of overtaken by events also. If you wrote a story in 1950 set in 1990, or famously Arthur C. Clarke's 2001, and we haven't made contact with a portal orbiting the moons of Jupiter or Saturn, then you have to think, is this still science fiction? Is it historical fiction in such a way? And writers also deliberately set science fiction in the past as well. The crossover with romance I've already talked a little bit about with Anne McCaffrey, but also in general, it's just worth noting that romance is one of these genres that tends to absolutely cut across all the other ones. You can have romance in science fiction, fantasy, mainstream, historical, horror, they're all there. And there is a surprising amount of romance in science fiction, though not usually in the texts that are considered the great masterpieces. There's a prejudice against it. But if you think about some of the biggest selling and most influential science fiction, such as Star Wars, that's completely romance. And in fact, it's usually called space opera if the romance has taken the place of the technology and the future extrapolation and the discussion of future societies. Another big division that you can look at is that science fiction and fantasy are usually classified as non-realistic and contrasted to realism in fiction. I think that's completely wrong. Fantasy, indeed, tries very hard to be non-realistic. Stylistically, the best fantasy writers write in different styles. They try to be archaic. They try to be poetic. And science fiction does exactly the opposite of that. This is another place where I think we can contrast the two. Science fiction often tries to be more realistic than realism, talking about unrealistic things. In that sense, then, science fiction is very, very close to mainstream commercial realism, at least, say, pre-1980, before postmodernism, and before some of the changes in fiction came about. Science fiction wants to make people believe that what they're talking about is at least plausible, if not real, and following off the great editor John W. Campbell, who we're going to talk about in Lecture 4, we find science fiction writers trying to treat the amazing, impossible, different, not as gee whiz, but as, yes, that's a normal part of the furniture. That's what you'd normally see around you. You treat a matter compiler or a lightsaber as if it's an ordinary thing like a lawnmower or a deck chair. It's just there. It's just something that the characters use. And that creates this illusion of realism, of verisimilitude, if you want to put it that way. Science fiction has tried a lot of other different styles as well. I would say that straight realism is the dominant style. But for example, William Gibson's Neuromancer, the most celebrated book out of the 1980s in science fiction, borrows, or even you could say steals from, Jane Ann Phillips' 1979 collection, Black Tickets, the style that she develops there, this kind of headlong rush through sentences. If you read the two books next to each other, you see that Gibson was completely influenced by Phillips there. Ray Bradbury's science fiction stories are very mainstream in what they're trying to say, but stylistically, he's using science fiction so that he can do different things stylistically to try out poetic techniques that you can't get away with in mainstream fiction. Likewise, J.G. Ballard is doing the same thing. Stylistically, I would say also that science fiction tends to be linked to whatever is the lowest common denominator writing of its time period. So you get in the 1940s a lot of what you would call hard-boiled fiction, detective fiction, film noir kind of style, where there's a lot of hard drinking and people getting into fistfights and so forth. And the style is that way too, that kind of staccato style that's sort of pre-Hemingway or influenced by Hemingway, but not usually as good at doing it as Hemingway. Likewise, when you move on to the 60s and 70s, science fiction becomes much more experimental, and people try things like writing technical reports that are short stories that are also about things that didn't happen. J.G. Ballard is the king of doing this, but a lot of other writers did it, and Thomas Dish does it very, very well in Camp Concentration, making something into a diary that's also a science fiction story, that's also a collection of weird poems and observations, and we'll be looking at that in one of the future lectures also. Science fiction itself is often divided into two pieces. And this has a tendency to go together with stylistic innovation or with kind of fitting in stylistically to whatever's going on. And that is the hard and the soft. The boundaries are kind of hard to map precisely, but basically, hard science fiction is technologically driven. It talks about new tech. It tries to invent new tech. It talks about how tech influences societies. And the kind of kings of hard SF are people like Isaac Asimov, Arthur C. Clarke, Robert Heinlein, the big three of the 50s. They're former physicists and engineers. They worked in engineering professions, and they write a little bit like engineers would. They still develop characters, they have themes, but the future technology is always in the spotlight. If it's Asimov, it's robots, and what are robots doing, and what are the laws of robotics, and so forth. If it's Heinlein, he usually comes up with three or four technological innovations and kind of pushes them through his story. Even something like Frank Herbert's Dune, which would seem to be kind of soft because of the mysticism involved in it, is very hard because there is a rationale and a plausibility and an explanation in terms of the laws of physics and chemistry for just about everything in there. Soft science fiction, on the other hand, if you at least listen to the people who don't like it, uses science fiction as an excuse to write about other things, usually to write about the world we live in today in some kind of different spin. Star Wars is obviously soft science fiction. There's no explanation how a lightsaber works, and even later on when George Lucas attempted to ruin his own work by inventing these midichlorians that live in your bloodstream and make you have the Force, it still is really, really soft science fiction. Margaret Atwood's The Handmaid's Tale, always considered to be science fiction. It's not really science fiction at all. I mean, there's an environmental catastrophe, which is not exactly fiction, sadly. It's just extrapolated a little bit more in Atwood. And there's no new tech. There's no new examination of how society might change that way. It's simply futurism. It's an abstraction. It's still a very good book, but it's not really science fiction. Or if it is, it's so soft that it's hard to see it as fitting in. In soft science fiction, however, the inner lives of characters, the themes that the author is working with become much more important, and that allowed science fiction to kind of get out of the science fiction box and to experiment and to look at new things. So great books of soft science fiction would include things like Samuel R. Delaney's Babel 17, Ursula Le Guin's Left Hand of Darkness. These are soft. There's no real explanation as to how much of this stuff works, but yet it's also really science fiction. It's not just there as an excuse. They're wanting to look at how a future society or a different society might work, but they are still using the tropes of science fiction. Satirists like Kurt Vonnegut or George Orwell might count as soft science fiction. I think that really they're just not quite science fiction. They're their own category. They're satirists. They're criticizing contemporary society by using science fiction to look at that. But it's certainly a possibility to see them as another version of soft. One of the problems with that is that soft science fiction was really seen as coming out of the 60s and 70s, and Orwell, Aldous Huxley's Brave New World, they are really much earlier. They're coming out of the 30s and 40s. So it kind of messes up that dichotomy if you accept them. So that's one reason to kind of hold them to the side. Even the very foundation of the science fiction genre, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, which we'll discuss in the next lecture, is pretty much soft science fiction. Brian Aldiss would say, and has said, that Shelley is hard science fiction. It's just what was hard science fiction in 1831, and we have to accept that. I don't entirely agree, because Shelley does do things like mention some specific scientists and have an idea generally about unifying alchemy with new chemistry, but she didn't know enough about it to make it hard science fiction, and I don't think she really cared. She wanted to get to her big idea, which we'll discuss in the next lecture, about what happens when you create something and then the creation is rejected by the creator. So that's what we'll talk about in the next lecture. Other critics, such as Robert Scholes, want to change the name of science fiction entirely and call it speculative fiction so that they can lump all together hard science fiction, soft science fiction, historical fiction, anything that didn't happen, except for fantasy. For whatever reason, there's a kind of a prejudice against fantasy that way. I think that that is also a mistake because there's some real genre conventions and some real traditions involved in science fiction. And it's important to see that works come out of a tradition. Now, they might not follow the tradition. They might explicitly try to reject the tradition. A good example of that kind of rejection of tradition but still being influenced by it is Rudy Rucker's Software and all his other ware books, freeware, hardware, so forth, which are intended to refute Isaac Asimov's laws of robotics. So you have this tradition, and if you just read Rudy Rucker's Software by itself, you don't understand why he's so upset about Asimov's laws of robotics. Likewise, there's things in the tradition such as Robert Heinlein's Starship Troopers, which made so many people so angry. We'll talk about why, and we'll look at Starship Troopers specifically and see that I think that some of those people are wrong. But in any event, Heinlein's Starship Troopers made people angry, and so Harry Harrison came and wrote Bill the Galactic Hero as an attempt to refute Starship Troopers. And you have a long tradition of people doing that and building on it. I think that Neal Stephenson's Snow Crash and The Diamond Age are coming off of Robert Heinlein's The Moon is a Harsh Mistress in a lot of ways, though no one's ever officially gotten Stephenson to admit that. It seems that Stephenson is trying to engage with the same sorts of ideas and then come to his own conclusions. So I want to reject the idea of speculative fiction as being this umbrella term. I think science fiction is a good way to go. We're going to stick with the science fiction genre. Speculation's an important part, but it's not the only part. The other reason I want to reject speculative fiction or speculation is because that brings into the genre a bunch of material that I'm not sure is even literature, much less science fiction. For example, H.G. Wells wrote a lot of material in the 1920s and 30s that was kind of guessing what the future would be like or trying to make the future be like a certain way, but it wasn't really even fiction. It was just like a description of this future world that he wanted it to be. Jules Verne's first book, which wasn't published till 100 years after he wrote it, after he'd become obviously very famous and someone found it, was called Paris in the 20th Century. And in it, he tries to explain what Paris is going to be like, but there's not really characters and action and the kind of things that you see in science fiction. So I want to take futurism, and being a little close-minded, I want to shove futurism that doesn't have characters and story off to one side as a separate genre. These are books that probably would sell anyway, even when they came out now, sell in possibly nonfiction or in the business writing or something like that, not in fiction. So I want to hold those boundaries a little bit, even though I acknowledge that the boundaries have to be kind of porous and fuzzy. There's also a lot more to science fiction than just guessing what the future will be or predicting technology. The best science fiction does a lot more. It gives readers a sense of what could be possible. It lets people get their heads around ideas that are coming down the future, whether it's bioengineering, manipulation of the human genome, different kinds of societies. It's good that science fiction goes out there in front and lets us speculate, lets us think about it. George Orwell's 1984, if it is science fiction, has done an enormous benefit to the world because people are worried about surveillance. People are worried about the government getting power to look into your homes in some way. And that's a good thing. And that's one of the real benefits of science fiction. But science fiction, just like all literature, goes way beyond that. Because what it does is it starts to expand the circle. It expands the circle of what we think of as human. And if you go back in literary history or in any history, that circle started out awfully small. If you go all the way back to the ancient Greeks, the circle of who was actually human really included wealthy, property-owning warriors. Women weren't included, slaves weren't included, non-Greeks weren't included. It was a very small group. And over time, that group has grown larger and larger. In the Middle Ages, that group officially contained all Christians in the West and in Europe. Now, it's true that women weren't really treated that way, but they were at least considered human in an effective way. And they continued to grow. And obviously, with the civil rights struggles in the 19th century and in the 20th century, the elimination of slavery, that circle grew larger still. In contemporary times, we're working on expanding that circle, for example, to the mentally handicapped, or to at least accepting people of other cultures as being equally human. But it's an enormous task. And science fiction, literature also, all literature, but particularly science fiction, does a great job of doing this. The novelist Iris Murdoch wrote, "The purpose of literature, the purpose of the novel, is to prove that other people really exist." In other words, to show that other people have just as rich and intelligent and a complex engagement with reality as you do, as we all do. Well, science fiction takes that and pushes it and pushes it and pushes it. Literature can do it too, but think what science fiction can do. It can make you identify with a robot, with an artificial consciousness, with a hideous alien, with a monster, with an insane person, with someone whose brain has been transmitted across the galaxy into a new body. All of these things can be expanded. Science fiction can challenge some of our most deeply held prejudice, and because it's popular literature, because it's enjoyable literature, it actually has a chance to work. Now, I don't want to limit everything just to politics, but think of what science fiction does in the work of someone like Samuel R. Delaney. Samuel R. Delaney, when he started writing in the 1960s, kept secret parts of his life that are now very open, his sexuality and his involvement in multiple relationships and so forth. But it's there in Babel 17. And I read Babel 17 when I was 13 years old, with all the closed-mindedness of your average 13-year-old growing up in the suburbs. And here there are people in Babel 17 living in what's called a triple. Two men, one woman, sexually and emotionally and in every way linked so that they can accomplish a certain task, which is navigating a starship. And Delaney makes that absolutely natural and absolutely real. And even to a kind of closed-minded person, you have to like those people. That's the power of science fiction. The power to explore different sorts of social arrangements. Robert Heinlein's Moon is the Harsh Mistress posits a future libertarian society on the moon where there's almost no rules except that, of course, people defend themselves. Now, I'm not sure I'd like to live there. But what he's done with Luna is give us a new way of looking at organization, a new way of looking at society. Ursula Le Guin does the same sort of thing in The Left Hand of Darkness. What if everyone was neuter except for one time a month they turned either masculine or feminine? How would society be different? I have no idea if what Le Guin has figured out is right, but it gives us a way to speculate about what sorts of things are inherently masculine, inherently feminine, and what else are cultural constructions. Science fiction also pushes the frontiers of what we can do. And as I'm going to argue when we get to discussion of the 1940s and 50s, civilizations yearn for frontiers. A frontier is somewhere you can go to get away from the civilization that's oppressing you. A frontier is somewhere you can go to experience new things and to change yourself. And science fiction is all about changing yourself in some way. And as the real frontiers got closed off, as Antarctica and the highest mountains and the deepest oceans and the most inaccessible jungles all were explored and mapped in the 1950s, science fiction pushed those new frontiers to outer space, to inner space, to technology, to the human mind. And by doing so, it gave people a new way to dream and a new frontier to engage with. And this is really important. I mean, this becomes a little bit more folk sociology at this point and not so much literary criticism. But the closure of the frontier, the failure in many ways of the space program, has changed the dynamic of life in the world, has changed the culture, because it's not clear that there are a lot of places to go anymore. And it's very exciting for me as a literary critic and as a scholar to see that in the 1990s, that kind of depression about the space program and about the colonization of the solar system and everything kind of was overcome when Kim Stanley Robinson starts writing his Mars books. So science fiction does that kind of expansion of the circle of possibilities, both in terms of individuals that we recognize as human and also in terms of what we can do and where we're going to go as a species and as a culture. So what we're going to do in the rest of the course is we're going to start at the beginning. We're going to talk about the early history of science fiction, Frankenstein, Jules Verne, and H.G. Wells. Then we're going to move on to the 1930s. Really, so we're jumping a little bit, and there's some reasons for that. We're going to talk about mysterious lore and marvelous tech, everything from Hugo Gernsback to H.P. Lovecraft and L. Sprague de Camp, and what was going on in the 1930s that set the foundation for the rest of at least American science fiction. Then we turn to the 1940s, the so-called Golden Age, the hard-boiled science fiction of John W. Campbell and Isaac Asimov. And then we'll move on to the grand master of them all, Robert Heinlein. Now, Robert Heinlein, some people hate him, some people love him, some people think he's irrelevant, but I think he defines early science fiction. And he was a great writer for what he did. So we're going to spend an entire lecture going over Heinlein, and we could spend an entire course on Heinlein. There's so much material. Then we move on to the 50s, which I'm calling Onward, Outward, and Apocalypse. And it's the kind of contradictory strands of 1950s culture, where we'll have this very optimistic charging into the future idea. And I'm actually going to talk about Cordwainer Smith, because I think he's the best writer out of that group. And also we have apocalypticism, the destruction of the world, which becomes a big deal in the 1950s, and a big trope in science fiction from then on. When we get to the 60s and 70s, I'm going to lump those two together in certain ways because the same sorts of things were going on. I want to talk about the three Ds, Philip K. Dick, Thomas Dish, and Samuel Delaney, the three of the great writers out of the new wave of the 1960s and 70s who really redefined the genre of science fiction. And then we're going to look in two separate lectures at the two big divisions within that new wave material. The first of these I'm calling the world builder, Frank Herbert. You know Frank Herbert from Dune, the best-selling science fiction book of all time, but actually Herbert had a large body of work, and he was a brilliant, brilliant writer, as we'll see, engaging in really important big questions and in world-building and inventing complete and rich and very, very beautiful worlds in a way that no one had done before, but many, many people have done since. And then we're going to talk about the surrealists. These were people, the three Bs, J.G. Ballard, William Burroughs, and Ray Bradbury, who were writing science fiction in certain ways to try to imitate surrealist art. We're going to talk about how they focused on style and how they tried to make science fiction into something more than just storytelling. Then we move on to the 1980s, the famous cyberpunk decade, and William Gibson's Neuromancer, and talk about some of the other writers that were associated with Gibson, Bruce Sterling, for example, but mostly focus on Gibson because he's been so influential and because at least the first few books are so great and such monuments in the genre. Then we move on to post-punk or slipstream writing. That's Neal Stephenson. Neal Stephenson is, in my opinion, the greatest science fiction writer working today. And so we're going to go through an entire lecture on Stephenson, though not focus on any one particular book. Then we're going to do a whole separate chapter on women and gender. This may seem a tiny bit old-fashioned, but I'm going to justify why there needs to be a separate chapter on women. And we're going to focus on Octavia Butler and Ursula K. Le Guin, the two great titans of women's science fiction. Then, our second to last chapter are the satirists. Now, whether they're actually science fiction or not, they're definitely worth looking at. And these include Orwell, Aldous Huxley, Kurt Vonnegut, and even, especially for a little bit of well-justified comic relief, Douglas Adams and his Hitchhiker's Guide stories. Finally, we're going to go to the 1990s and beyond, looking at the two kind of signature writers of that time period, except for Stevenson, who has his own section. Those are Kim Stanley Robinson and his Mars books, and Greg Egan, who's probably the hottest hard science fiction writer to come out of the 90s and to still be writing today. We're also going to take a quick look at all the other great books that I couldn't stick into the other lectures, at least to give you their names and suggest you go read them. And finally, we'll see what kind of conclusions we can draw about science fiction, and to see if, after looking at all this material, if we really can expand the circle, and if science fiction really can contribute something to the culture beyond what mainstream literature can contribute. I think you'll agree that after we've gone on this very long voyage, that science fiction is definitely worthy of study and worthy of more attention than perhaps critics have given it in the past.
This ends Lecture 1. From here to infinity, Lecture 2, The Roots of Science Fiction.
In this lecture, we're going to go through basically the 19th and the very early 20th century. Now, I will say no less a writer than Vladimir Nabokov said that Shakespeare's The Tempest is the earliest science fiction novel if you wanted to follow the very strict rules of the genre. In that, in The Tempest, Shakespeare is giving a mechanism a little bit. There's Ariel, the spirit who gives Prospero his power and so forth. And I've actually taught The Tempest in a science fiction class, but all due respect to Mr. Nabokov, I don't think Shakespeare's The Tempest is really science fiction. I agree with Brian Aldiss that the first novel that you can at least think about being science fiction is Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley was born right around the turn of the century, between the 1700s and the 1800s. And when she was only 19 years old, that is, in 1818, she published Frankenstein. Now, actually, not many people paid attention to it when it was first published in 1818. But when the edition of 1831 came out, it became enormously popular and enormously influential. And many people would say that it founded the Gothic genre. And there's some truth to that. There's this famous story that Mary Shelley and her husband, Percy Shelley, and Lord Byron, and many other writers were at a kind of lakeside retreat, and it was a dark and stormy night, and they all agreed to write some ghost stories or tell ghost stories, and out of that came Frankenstein. And there's the whole argument that really Frankenstein is by her husband, the great poet, and she just kind of wrote things down. I don't agree with either of that. I think that it's got its own sensibility, and the particular night story from which Gothic comes out of and so forth, that's nice. But you can tell that Mary Shelley spent a lot of time developing these ideas. And Frankenstein is a very, very intellectual book. Shelley is engaged with important things that are going on kind of in the time period and philosophically, and she's trying to work them out for herself. So yes, she was only 19 and a great achievement, but let's look at the actual achievement of the book rather than being so caught up in how old she was when she wrote it. It's important to note that Frankenstein is not the name of the monster. So many people think the name of the monster is Frankenstein, but actually Frankenstein is the name of the creator of the monster, Dr. Frankenstein. And what he has done in the book is figure out a way to reanimate dead flesh or to bring life to non-living flesh. It's actually kind of unclear in a few places. He's visited charnel houses, and charnel houses were places where bodies were put to rot. So then you could get the bones later on and put the bones in your family ossuary, but not the rotting body. So young Frankenstein, it's not the comedy film, but the actual young Dr. Frankenstein, he's not even a doctor yet, he's before he's gone to school, has studied the great alchemists, people like Paracelsus and Albertus Magnus. And these people, even in the early 19th century, were beginning to be completely discredited. It was seen that alchemy had been a 500-year dead end, and real chemistry was being developed at this time. And this is where Aldous says that Shelley really is science fiction, and where I disagree with him, because Shelley has Frankenstein having studied all these great alchemists and then going off to school at the German university, and there's a few German professors, and they make fun of him. They're like, how could you possibly think that these people were worth studying? And it seems to be that Frankenstein kind of unifies the old-fashioned alchemy with the modern chemistry. But it's not entirely clear, because some of the things that characters say suggest that he's completely rejected alchemy and he's just picked up the new chemistry. In any event, it's really just kind of a lot of, you know, saying some names of people. There's no background science. She doesn't explain where it comes from. And this lack was definitely felt when the film was made. Because the big thing about the film is it's set up right around the time of the discovery of electricity, of the manipulation of electricity, I should say. People knew about electricity. Alexander Volta and animal magnetism and stuff goes back well before the film. But the idea is that Frankenstein has figured out that by putting electricity into flesh, he can bring about new life. This was not unheard of at all. The idea of it was pretty mainstream when the film was written. But there's nothing like that at all in the book. It's all chemistry in some sense. The other thing that people get confused between the book and the film is the monster is not evil to begin with in the book. In fact, he's completely pure of heart. And to me, the very best parts of the book are when the monster is first kind of coming awake to consciousness and figuring out how to use language and figuring out how to perceive the world. These are very kind of hallucinogenic, almost trippy images that are in this 19th century book about how the monster would go from kind of perceiving just kind of masses of color into realizing that they're shapes and that they have properties and that language is not just noises. It's really very beautifully done. So the monster's not evil at all. He's pure of heart. But he's been rejected. He's been rejected by his creator, which at first he doesn't even really realize because he can't understand anything. And then he hides kind of in a woodpile and listens to this family. And you get the whole little story, very Victorian, of this family and its troubles. And the young man is going to marry this woman who's a refugee. And the father has been unfairly deprived of money. And he's blind and so forth and so on. And the monster helps them by chopping and gathering wood for them at night while they're sleeping. The monster doesn't seem to need sleep very much. He hardly needs to eat. He's incredibly strong and tough because of his genesis. And so he helps his family out, and finally he wants to present himself to the family. He's learned to speak French and German and English, I think. He's learned to read, and he wants to present himself to the family. And so he sneaks into the house and speaks to the blind father. And the blind father and him have a very nice conversation, and they like each other and so forth. And then the sighted family come home, see the monster, freak out, scream, everybody runs away, the monster's chased off, and he's miserable. And he tries to go back to his creator, and his creator just rejects him. You're horrible, you're a monster, you're dreadful. And this is why the title is called Frankenstein or the Modern Prometheus, in a sense. The modern Prometheus, Dr. Frankenstein, has brought fire, has brought life in some way, that just like the classical Prometheus. But it's also, in some ways, kind of Miltonic, what's going on here, because it's the anger of the creation at its creator that doesn't pay attention to it and doesn't love it. So it's a twist on Milton in some ways. And the monster, because he's so furious at this and becomes so miserable, decides to punish Frankenstein, mostly by murdering his friends, associates, and relatives. Finally, the monster and Frankenstein confront each other, and the monster says to Frankenstein, I'll make you a deal. I will go to the farthest jungles or the highest mountains. I will leave the world of men forever if you'll make me a companion. Frankenstein's so broken down and miserable, and he's seen all these friends die, that he agrees to do this. They go off to this island off England, and he makes a new monster, a female monster, to be a companion. This is the bride of Frankenstein. Of course, that movie was not serious, but it comes from the same ideas. And Frankenstein makes the new creature. He's just about to bring it to life, and then he realizes he can't do this, because what if they sired a race of horrible creatures? He doesn't trust the monster, even though from our point of view, since we've seen so many things from the monster's point of view, we'd think the monster would actually keep his promise, and so that the problem could have been solved. But Frankenstein destroys his creation. The monster sees this, and he says, I will get my final revenge. I will be with you on your wedding night. And he is. And then the rest of the book is the monster and Frankenstein pursuing each other through the Arctic ice so that they will eventually both be destroyed, and they are. That's how the book ends. So Frankenstein is usually interpreted, and I think misinterpreted, as a cautionary tale that says men cannot go so far, don't push science too far, or the creature will come back and destroy you. Certainly this is the message that everyone took out of Frankenstein, and this is the message that everyone takes out of the film particularly, and then all these other horror and monster films that follow the same template. But in fact, that's not what Shelley is saying. What Shelley is saying is that a creator has a responsibility to his creation, and if he fails in that responsibility, then there will be disaster and trouble. She doesn't say necessarily that all science shouldn't be pushed so far. He says something about being the pale student of the unhallowed arts and so forth. But it's not that kind of general anti-science approach that people use when they say Frankenstein, or people in political discourse when they talk about Frankenfoods and things like that are definitely trying to give the idea that science can go too far. That wasn't Shelley's view, and that makes sense because she's writing it in 1818 or, 1817, and really science hasn't gone very far at that point. So to see science as going too far in this book is a mistake. But it is a really important science fiction book because it suggests that the mechanism, even if it's not underdeveloped in Shelley, is really important to getting the story to work. It's not just pure magic, but there's some kind of mechanism. Frankenstein is also science fiction because the novel focuses on the personal and the social implications of a technological experiment. In other words, it's not just about, hey, I made a monster, but here's what happens when you make the monster and when it does what it does. The real focus of the novel is moral responsibility. And that's a really big point in a lot of science fiction. More science fiction than you would think is focused on the moral responsibility that people have for their creations and for the things that they do. Now, the success of Frankenstein in 1831 with that edition is very much related to the kind of flowering of genres in the Victorian period. And this has an economic basis. As there became more and more and more literate people, especially in England due to universal education laws, increasing literacy, and cheaper printing, there became more and more markets for literature. Literature was no longer just the preserve of the upper classes, the highly educated, those who had a lot of Latin and Greek, or churchmen, which is really what literature had been for a long time. There had always been oral tradition, but printed literature, the form of the novel, really gets going in the 18th century. And in the 19th century, it spreads out to the populace to really much larger levels. You have a phenomenon which nowadays is called the long tail, and that is the long tail of the bell curve, which is that for a very, very large population, you don't have to be in the center of the curve and still have large numbers. You can be something that only a subgroup of the population likes, but if that reading population is so much larger than the previous one, you can still be commercially successful. And so what you get in the Victorian period is what we would call market segmentation. You get fantasy, you get children's literature, you get romance and women's literature, you get moralistic and Christian literature, you get adventure and so forth. And in the Victorian period, there's this flowering of genres. You could even call it an adaptive radiation if you wanted to be evolutionary about it and Darwinian, and say there's all these new cultural niches into which writers create material that people will buy. The important thing to note about this then is it had to sell. For science fiction to be successful, it had to.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.